He's been called a savior by some and a dangerous political operative by others. Steve Bannon's a man who's rebranded racism as nationalism. And now he is Trump's chief strategist. And he was a key player in getting the Donald into the White House. Hey, I'm Tariq, and we're gonna walk you through how someone with such a low profile and ties to white supremacy rose to become one of the most powerful men in the United States. After years in prep school and later graduating from Virginia Tech, Bannon enlisted in the military, where he served from the late 70s to early 80s. During this time, Bannon grew disillusioned with then-President Jimmy Carter. He felt Carter's sole focus in the Persian Gulf was aimed towards protecting US oil interests from the nation's Cold War enemy, the Soviet Union. But in 1980, there was a turning point in US politics. California Governor Ronald Reagan came to power after inspiring millions with the slogan, "Let's make America great again." Sound familiar? Bannon left the Navy in 1983 to pursue his MBA at Harvard. He would eventually find his way to one of the biggest financial firms on Wall Street, Goldman Sachs. Bannon left the banking giant to start his own firm, Bannon & Co. The upstart connected big money financiers with huge Hollywood projects. And then 9/11 happened. Bannon threw all of his energy into producing and directing his own documentaries. But these weren't your average Netflix movies.
The liberal media don't matter to me. Republican establishment don't matter to me.
To hell with the establishment, because the establishment has put us in this position in the first place.
From 2004 to 2012, Bannon directed 9 films. His inspiration? Nazi propaganda filmmaker Leni Riefenstahl. Riefenstahl collaborated with Adolf Hitler in the 1900s to create films glorifying the Nazi Party. Throughout his career, Bannon's colleagues have described his work ethic as very intense. And parts of his personal life were just as intense. Bannon was married a few times. His second wife was Mary Louise Picard. She made headlines when reporters dug up a domestic violence report that she filed in 1996. Several years later, Steve and Mary Louise divorced and he married Diane Clohessy. Diane was an activist for a new political presence growing across the US, the Tea Party. Bannon identified with the group's mistrust in federal government and agreed with rolling back social welfare programs. Steve and Diane also called it quits, ending their marriage in 2009. That same year, Barack Obama was sworn in as the first black president, and the Tea Party hit the national stage. During the 2010 midterm elections, Bannon released the film Battle for America to fire up Tea Party supporters.
I shudder to imagine what an unchecked, unlimited Obama radicalism would be like in the next 2 years.
He has truly awakened the sleeping giant to a point where they are determined to take back America.
And Bannon's films were effective. Combined with the landmark Supreme Court case Citizens United, Tea Party-backed Republicans won big. 44 seats to be exact. In 2011, Bannon met Andrew Breitbart and the two became fast friends. Now, Breitbart.com was a conservative news organization that pandered to people who felt that Fox News was the establishment. Andrew Breitbart died in 2012. Steve Bannon took over and helped amplify anti-black, anti-Muslim, and anti-immigrant sentiment. He used Breitbart to cater to white supremacists. In that same year, conservative activist and Citizens United architect David Bossie would introduce Bannon to Donald Trump. The two reportedly hit it off, and it was at a time when Trump was in the early stages of considering a 2012 presidential run.
The country is doing very poorly. It just can't do much worse. We're not respected anywhere in the world. I am seriously thinking about it.
2012 wouldn't be Trump's year, but this Breitbart fan would find a 2016 campaign leader in Bannon. Remember when the Access Hollywood video was released with Trump's misogynistic comments? It was Bannon's idea to deflect the outrage by inviting Bill Clinton's sexual accusers to a press conference and the second presidential debate. Political maneuvers like that earned Bannon respect, the trust of Donald Trump, and ultimately the coveted chief strategist position. Lawmakers on the left and right were horrified and urged the Trump campaign to reconsider. As chief strategist, Steve Bannon has the ear of the president and access to the full resources of the state. This is a man who has elevated far-right Tea Party ideals to the highest office of the land. He mainstreamed what was once fringe to be front and center. Now, we can't predict what a Trump presidency will look like, but we can expect Steve Bannon to empower a platform of white supremacy, a platform that now has a seat at the table.